and move on to straddles. Now, straddles were created in 1982, and they were meant specifically to avoid situations where people were, and this frequently occurred in the commodity space, buying and selling two different futures contracts on the same underlier with an attempt to generate losses on one and gains on the other. They would then recognize the losses but not the gains, and then rehedge the position once the calendar year was closed out. Now, please note that this is prior to the 1256 rule, because some of you who have good experience with how commodities futures work, nowadays, if you buy and sell futures, you can do straddles all you want, because all the gains and losses are subject to the 60-40 rule, which is governed by Section 1256. But back in the 70s, that rule didn't exist. And so that meant that gains on futures were treated like capital gains and losses on other types of property. So you could buy and sell two different futures. If you bought two different futures that had similar expiration dates, but they were on the same commodity, you'd be pretty sure one was going to lose money, the other was going to make money. You took the one that was losing money, you closed that position out on December 31st, or whatever the final day of your tax year was, harvest those losses, and then on the first business day of the following year, you'd rehedge the position that had the unrealized gain. So that, therefore, you'd have one day of risk each year where maybe the unhedged position makes money, maybe it loses money, but whatever it makes or loses is going to be dwarfed by the amount of tax savings you're going to get by being able to recognize a huge loss on whatever position it was that you closed out on December 31st. Okay, so the goal of doing straddles back in the 70s was for taxpayers to generate losses, which they would typically offset other gains they had. And the great thing about straddles is you can manufacture long-term or short-term losses, depending on what you needed. And the goal of the straddles rule, when it was introduced, was to make it impossible to just buy and sell two different securities that had similar risk profiles in order to generate losses. So the way in which it works is that, like any of these other rules, that if you do this, if you do something that looks like a straddle, you cannot take those losses. And once again, it's not a question of disallowing them permanently, it's a question of shifting the losses. So the other thing that the rule affects is it affects the holding periods of the positions involved in the straddles, in order that it not only prevents you from tax loss harvesting, but also from mechanically converting long-term capital losses into short-term capital losses. As I said before, you could use a straddle to create either type, but what you really want, well, most taxpayers really want short-term capital losses, because short-term capital losses can be offset with short-term capital gains freely, whereas long-term capital losses are not as useful. So the test for whether or not two positions that offset, that the two positions that the taxpayer has present at the same time, whether or not they constitute a straddle or not, is based on whether one of the positions creates a substantial diminution of the taxpayer's risk of loss on the other position. So as you can imagine, if you're long a February silver future and short a March silver future, they're probably going to offset a fair amount of the risk of one another, because futures on silver are dictated by the underlying commodity price. So you can see there's a case where one offsets the risk of another. Buying a put option and buying a call option on the same underlier, by holding both a put and a call, the put offsets the risk of the call, and the call offsets the risk of the put. In fact, that's one thing I should do is disambiguate the use of the term tax straddle, which is what we're discussing here, Section 1092 of the tax code, versus a straddle trading strategy. Straddle trading strategy in the world of options is a frequently executed strategy in which a bet is placed on volatility. There are similarities between the two concepts, but they should not be confused with one another. So a straddle from tax purposes is when one position substantially diminishes the risk of loss on another position. Now, this is not the same as substantially identical, and do not think that one generally implies the other. However, it's much easier for one position to diminish the risk of loss from another position than it is for two positions to be construed as substantially identical. There are far more cases where two securities are going to be considered offsetting positions and can invoke a straddle than there are going to be cases of substantially identical. That being said, it is certainly possible to have things that offset other things' risk. For example, you might have two bonds. One has a different level of debt seniority than the other. Now, a bond trader might say, well, you know, the debt seniority level doesn't really matter in these two particular cases because the underlying issuer is so creditworthy that there's, you know, at this point in time, there's very little risk premium for the bond that has lower seniority. Now, the substantially identical rule calls out debt seniority as one thing that stops two bonds from being substantially identical. Now, if you trade these two bonds in the context of a straddle, well, guess what? You got a straddle. You can be long one of the bonds, short the other. One diminishes the risk of the other. No questions asked. These things are going to be offsetting. However, if you're long one, short the other, they're not a constructive sale. Now, there can be cases in the other direction where, you know, things are substantially identical, but maybe not risk offsetting. It's kind of hard to imagine one, but at least it's possible. So with that concept in place, you can see that some typical examples of straddles that can occur in real-world trading scenarios is where you're long a stock, short a call, long a stock, long a put, short a put, and some various others. But we do want to call out one classic example of the straddles rules, a classic example of something that is not a straddle, and that's a qualified covered call. Qualified covered call is when the taxpayer is long the stock and short a call option. Now, it's not always true that that combination creates a qualified covered call, which, by the way, is exempt from the straddle rule, but it can happen. And when it does happen, when a call qualifies as a qualified covered call, then you can ignore the straddle rule. Now, the mechanics of the straddle rule we should be able to get into with the next slide.